Congratulations, and thank you for what you have done, what you have given us, and even more important to me, for what you are about to do. Please transform this world. Please. Otherwise, what is the point? Why does Naropa University exist? Naropa's reason for being is what you do, how you act and engage our world from this day forth. Transform yourself, transform the world is a little bit of a koan. It's a radical aspiration, an expression of path, not goal, an expression of commitment, of intention. Not a plan or a strategy. It expresses at once our collective aspiration and a deeply held personal responsibility. A very radical combination of uncompromising personal discipline in the pursuit of an enlightened society and the alleviation of suffering. It is the sweet and sour calling of our ultimate aloneness and the tremendous compassion we feel for others. Lily Tomlin has always captured this tension for me best when she said, "Remember, we are all in this alone." I'm so pleased that you have a Naropa degree and that it will enhance your resume. No doubt it will open doors that would not be opened otherwise. But I salute and celebrate your secret CV, your inner resume, your inner ecology, not based on or relying on any past accomplishment or external confirmation. Your confidence and a generosity of presence that arises from the capacity to be with oneself, to know oneself, and be truthful with oneself, and then to act from that place of clarity. You may have been told at orientation now years ago that a key thread of Naropa education is to develop a beginner's mind. This is the mind that Suzuki Roshi talks about when he says, "In the beginner's mind, there are many possibilities. In the expert's mind, there are few." Well, this is still the case at graduation. As you know, more training and more courage are required to bring a beginner's mind into a situation than the sophisticated mind of the expert. As I tell my students, yes, even a lawyer can indeed have a beginner's mind. The certain mind, the made-up mind, is guaranteed to be caught by surprise, in fact, ambushed, perhaps devastated by the unexpected, while the open mind is prepared for, even delighted by, the unanticipated and the unscripted. For the parents who are now worried that they have paid many thousands of dollars of college tuition and still the president is praising the virtue of beginner's mind, I should perhaps reassure them by quoting Malcolm Forbes, that preeminent capitalist, "Education's purpose is to replace an empty mind with an open one." The practice of beginner's mind is a key, but beginning to engender a trust in it, a confidence that we can move through the world in this fashion, is also significant to the influence I trust you will have on the world around you. This is a true confidence, which is not dependent on anything, even past accomplishment, or for that matter, the past itself. It is a confidence not based in knowledge, but in understanding. It is a confidence not based in a superior strategy, or in fact, any strategy, but rather the confidence of no strategy and of no expectation, a confidence coming from the inside out. It is the confidence of just being, a comfort, a relaxation in the present moment, regardless of what is happening. When our perceptions, our senses open, and the world shoots straight to the heart, unclouded, undistorted. This is what B.H. Lawrence describes poetically as the cool, unlying life rushing in. I wish for you the cool, unlying life. I trust that Naropa education has prepared you to be spontaneous, develop the confidence in improv, all the things that totally freaked out my Ivy League educated persona, but are essential to our very survival. In short, you can navigate an uncertain, unpredictable, rapidly changing world. We have no clue as to what's going to happen next, but all of us would like to be there when it happens. Except perhaps for Woody Allen, highlighting my very point with the opposite. I'm not afraid to die, I just don't want to be there when it happens. All kidding aside, we all want to be there when it happens, whatever it may be. Otherwise, as John Lennon said to his young son in a lyric, life is what happens to you while you are making other plans. The world is a challenging place, and these are challenging times. Indeed, as David Orr points out, many of these problems have been brought about by the most academically certified of us. It brings to mind the requirement of a terminal degree, in the sense that if you value your degree from the outside in, you are likely to cause real trouble. The temptation is to believe the problem's solid, the issues too polarized, and the institutions too entrenched, and that we are uniquely trapped. To believe that our own future is more unique, perhaps more dark, more intractable, or as Yogi Berra, my favorite yogi. My favorite yogi opined wisely, the future ain't what it used to be. On that point, my father graduated from college in the Roaring Twenties, June 1929. His mother was an heiress, and he was a child of privilege. He was given a trip through Europe, not for the first time, by the way, as a graduation present. I have some photos of that trip, which would make F. Scott Fitzgerald jealous. He returns to America, probably thinking at some point, maybe he should ask a family friend for a job. In October, the stock market crashes, his mother is financially wiped out, the so-called family friends disappear, and my father starts from scratch. Through the Great Depression, 3 years in the Navy, World War II, the Cold War, and on and on. I graduated from college in 1966. Given the post-graduation choice of Vietnam or graduate school, took me a while to make up my mind. I chose graduate school and then Vista. We had the New Frontier, the Freedom Rides, Jim Crow, and the Great Society. John Kennedy was killed at 63, Bobby Kennedy and Martin Luther King in 68. Our cities were in flames. We were raining napalm in Vietnam and Cambodia. Rachel Carson wrote The Silent Spring in 1962. We continued raining DDT on the Americas. The birds of my childhood disappeared. Complete senselessness reigned. I'm not reciting this little bit of family history to start a generational who had the worst argument, but merely to say that Yogi is always is right. The future is never what it used to be. Relax, and I use that word not in its frivolous take a holiday sense, because the future is beyond any control. That thinking about our future, labeling our future, being anxious about our future, believing it, our unique, personal, oh my God, future, never shapes our future. And particularly in this entitlement culture, the seduction of getting something or somewhere to ensure our future threatens our lives in ways that are unhealthy, stultifying, and imprisoning. For both ourselves and our planet, whether we graduate in 1929, 1966, or 2012. And as you well know, the only antidote is the inner diploma, the inner work. No one is going to liberate us. We have to liberate ourselves, moment to moment. Nor can we liberate anyone else except by liberating ourselves. For the world to change, we need to risk stepping off the moving walkway of narcissism, to be daring in the moment, to step beyond our cozy cocoon, all the quid pro quos of our thinking mind, and allow our hearts to do the talking, to enter the conversation. This is risky business, whether it is in the courtroom, at home, at the dinner table, writing poetry, waiting tables, or in a therapy session. To a great degree, we have no choice, for in the words of that great Denver Airport seer, the moving walkway is nearing its end. It's always nearing its end, and just when we thought we were on automatic pilot, we'll be launched into the unknown over and over again. This is our constant practice, and it is our discipline, the confidence the world needs. You and I need to welcome all the possibilities, to invite the myriad of questions, not seduced by glib habitual answers or cloying assumptions about reality. Entrapment or liberation is our choice. We can be imprisoned by the past or fixated on an uncontrollable future, and in doing so, miss the moment. The moment that is full of life, possibility of surprise and of creativity, even Gordian knots unraveled, and yes, a transformation of change for self and other. This sacred world is full of sweet and sour, blossoms and thorns, unbearable kindness and cruelty. Exquisite birds with the voices of gods, the drawlers that our grandchildren may never see. Deception dressed up as truth, exhilaration and suffering. And I wish upon you, I wish for you, a growing glimmer of equanimity. In that regard, of course, I wish you all the success in life. I am so Machiavellian and perhaps crass to wish that one of you, just one of you, becomes a billionaire. And I want to go forward. I wish you success, and only a Naropa graduate would understand this. May your life also be enriched by mishap. It's a rather radical thing for a president to say to the graduating class, but may your life be enriched by mishap. Or to quote Henry David Thoreau as a backup, this is a problem for the parents as well, no employees, I don't know. If we will be quiet and ready enough, we shall find compensation in every disappointment. Linked to a growing equanimity, and what Michael talked about as well, the last piece of advice is to practice with the small things. Don't wait for the 2x4 upside the head, as I did when in 2004, Byard and I sat across from the doctor who wouldn't look us in the eye, only at the lab reports in front of him saying, "This doesn't look good and I can't help you anymore." So practice with the small things, the little rebuffs, the pinpricks to the heart, the slight pace of road rage, the guy with the really irritating shirt sitting in front of you in group meditation. Your partner who won't do the dishes, the hollow flattery that seduces you in, the personally offensive and insufferable length of the Naropa University commencement. whatever it is, see it clearly, the power it has over you. Its ephemeral nature, even the myth illusion of a solid and separate self. Work out with 5-pound weight over and over again, and you will be surprised by your growing equanimity. So thank you again. What I saw walking across the stage here is truly awesome, world-changing. For the clarity and genuineness of beginner's mind, the presence it engenders, the confidence of body, speech, and mind radiates outward. The Tibetans call it Zijin, literally translated as shine or brilliance, or what I like for the Naropa graduates, splendor. I wish the founder were here to see you, for no doubt he would say, in perfect Oxonian, absolutely splendid. The world is desperate for what you have. You are the potent catalyst for enlightened society. Your inner lives have enriched my life. I have been blessed to be your president. Thank you, and good luck.